doing well this morning. Great crowd, great looking bunch. You're smiling, you're talkative, you're excited. That's a good thing. We have a lot to be excited about, don't we? This means yes. And it's okay to talk, say amen. Yes. In terms of announcements, if you look in your bulletin, the insert there, they've also been rolling over their head. But just a few things I want to point out, remind us of. Choir practice will resume today, 4:45. And the greeting of the church will take place on Tuesday. That's at 6 o'clock on Tuesday afternoon. Also, Wonderful Wednesday will resume this week on the 11th. And just a couple of points of emphasis for that. Our meal will begin promptly at 6. So please plan to be here and start eating at 6. Because the Bible study portion will actually be moved up and start at 6:45. So again, start eating promptly at 6, according to Steve's watch. And then at 6:45, we'll start the Bible study. And Ava, do you want to say a word about the Bible study? Bible study, 6:45, Wednesday. So make plans to come. Great way to start off the new year. Also this morning we had a great group of men for our monthly men's breakfast. Robert Berkson had our devotion for us this morning. Harold. And if you missed it, I'm sorry. Harold. Thank you, Robert Berkson, for what you shared, what you said. So, make plans to attend our next meeting, which will be the first Sunday of February. This month it was moved back 1 week because of New Year's Day being last Sunday. But anyway, make plans to attend. With that being said, the ladies meet next Sunday morning with Thomas Staff, 8:45. So, a lot of things going on, a lot of opportunities. Take part, be a part, and be glad that you do. Todd McIntyre has an announcement to make. Before that, are there any other announcements? And also, Beth has an announcement to make. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to pass around right now the sign-up sheet. If anyone wants to come with the children's program or do that, that'll start next week, the 15th at 4, the choir practice, and then 4:30
for
the children's program. So please come. We'd love to have
them all. Okay. Beth?
Because it's a grassroots denomination in the Global Methodist Church, there's been no portion of faith into that, so they really don't have a transportation process, if you will, moving offset expenditure. So that being said, our pastor, Gary and Deborah, coming from Ohio, I'd like to take up a love offering to help offset their transportation costs because they're paying the mover to move And he's supposed to be here next Sunday in the pulpit. So we're looking forward to welcoming him. And anything we can do to get him to help him with that transportation, God just wanted here. Memo line, love offering, and we'll see what we'll do about it. Thank y'all.
I sent out an email to all of the women that I have from Women's Group, but this is for everybody. We're trying to do accounting for them. So we might need to just change the date on when we need items, because I had said Thursday, which is the 12th, because we thought it was going to be here Friday, but I do think it's going to be here Thursday.
Is he going to be here with the truck? He's not coming till Friday, right?
Truck. I'm not sure. Last I saw, the truck will be here on Wednesday, when it closes Thursday. He's on that Friday, but I'm not sure he'll actually be here.
Okay. We'll let you know.
It says Booker's Cross opening in 11 in Cincinnati. The drive is open from the 12th. And the 13th, hopefully they'll unload the ride.
So the 13th.
So if you had the real dish.
Thank God. Just sitting here on the way.
Late and 12. Is what it's playing.
Where is that from?
Chris.
Oh, yeah.
Just like we don't know when Jesus is coming back. He knows the hour that he's coming, both Jesus and the preacher. He's coming here. So next Sunday, Pastor Kerry Wood will be here, start his new appointment with us. Also, Brittany asked me to announce about the custodial position that's still available. If you're interested in that or know someone who may be interested, see Chris Hart and let him know you're interested in doing that. It's been open for a while. Pete and Kristen do a fantastic job and have done for many, many months and years. But now we're looking for someone to take that spot. So, anything else?
Hey,
yes, ma'am.
Just another reminder of writing checks, Galston Methodist Church.
Okay. Patricia says, a friendly reminder, when you're making your checks out, make it payable to Galston Methodist Church, Inc. Also, we all have good news to share. We have the best news to share, but I'll share something good with you. Today, you won't listen to me. We have Pastor Val Chadwick with us today and his wife, Sue. We welcome them. Val is preached in this community for many, many years. A good friend of mine, glad to have you with us today. They also joined us for Sunday school. Many of you know Val and Sue. And again, we welcome you here today, and you're going to be hearing from him a little bit later on in the service. Thank you for being here today. We welcome you. Anything else?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Already. We'll move forward with bringing in the light of Christ. Thank you. Please stand and we'll sing the manual.
Okay.
Thank you.
standing and join with me in reciting the opening prayer. Perfect light of revelation, as you shone in the life of Jesus, whose epiphany we celebrate, so shine in us and through us, that we may become beacons of truth and compassion, enlightening all creation with deeds of justice and mercy. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Our hymn of praise is 384, Love Divine, All Loves Excel. Thank you.
again, as I say each Sunday, isn't that a beautiful sight?
Yes.
Fantastic. At this time, we'll have our prayers, our joys and concerns. I think last Sunday I failed to ask for joys, but today I want to make sure that we do that. So I ask that we start with some joys that we may share this morning.
A little over 3 years ago, I stood here. This young lady right here, she was leaving a child, and there you go, she came home. I'm now known as the surprise king. But we're so happy to have Hannah. All the joy it is to have her back with us, even in a short period of time. She's going to be here longer than we thought, maybe a month, which we're really excited about. But that's our goal.
Yes. You're right, Tim. That is our jewel. Thank you. It's great to see you, Hannah. Always great to see your beautiful smile. I hope it's contagious. Others?
Dale,
yes, ma'am.
It's a joy to see Hannah Harris.
Yes, it is. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am. Yes, that's what I was looking at. I kept looking at him. I wanted one of them to say it. Yes. Patrick, stand up. Patrick was named the 2022 Fireman of the Year for Golston Fire Department. So, Patrick, well deserved. Thank you for what you do. And again, that's for all of us. Thank you. Day in and day out, nights, holidays, weekends, whenever, when we're eating our Thanksgiving lunch, he's out helping us and taking care of us. So, thank you. Well deserved. Congratulations. That's awesome. Prayer concerns. Yes, Kim.
Well, Jeremiah, Boss's daughter, Morgan, I can't remember her last name.
Fantastic. We serve a great God. You're hearing reminders right now. Keep it up. Are there prayer concerns that you would share?
Today, a friend of mine, Roy Spencer, is in the hospital with UNC. He's in critical condition. He needs
Let's remember Roy Stinson, also Sims Poindexter, as she continues to undergo different medical procedures. She had one earlier this week, so let's continue to remember her. And so many that are still suffering from flus, viruses, COVID, you know, just a number of things that just keep lingering on. So remember those folks.
Now, that the president is having some issues with the back.
Okay. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
My dad fell yesterday. He really sore. He may have broken some ribs, but just pray to have a quick healing process.
Okay, prayers for Johnny Clark, who fell yesterday and potentially suffered some ribs, rib injuries. That's very painful. Anyone else? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear God, thank you for who you are. Thank you for the blessings. Thank you for this time that we have to worship. This exciting. You're a great God, and again, thank you for who you are. Thank you for the testimony that's been shared this morning to confirm the evidence of the great God that you are. Almighty God. And we have a great story to share. Lord,
the names that have been mentioned, also those that are in our hearts and minds that have not been named aloud. We continue to pray for those. For all the needs, the circumstances, all things that you're completely aware of, Lord, we just pray that you will attend to that need and help us, Lord, to do our part as willing servants to inspire, to encourage, to love, and to share, and to be present, to help, and to be a God, or be like God to them. Help us to be who you are to them. Lord, again, we thank you for our time together. We thank you for the opportunity to worship through men's group this morning, through Sunday school, through a time of worship, through the kids, through prayer, through song. There's so many great things that we have to be thankful for. And Lord, those things, again, that are heavy on our hearts, we just submit them to you. We thank you for Val, who has come today to share God's word as we worship through the spoken word. I just pray, Lord, that you will speak through him. And Lord, we also pray for our church as we prepare for our new pastor coming in. Pastor Kerry Wood and his wife Deborah will be here next Sunday. Lord, just help us to be in a time of prayer. Help us to do our part. Help us to be that beacon of light. Help us to be hope and light in a dark world. Forgive us when we fail you and keep us in thy care. And again, thank you for who you are. Thank you for watching over us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now join me in the prayer of confession that you see overhead. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love.
Hold on.
Father, forgive us if we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God.
Amen. And now if you will join the hymn of preparation, O How I Love Jesus, hymn number 107. Or maybe it's 219. It's one of the other. It's a great
thank you.
Remain standing and recite with me together in prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds
by the power of your Holy Spirit, as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
Children's sermon and see if we know any more about the children though. So Matthew 24, Jesus is addressing his disciples. Thank you for the invitation. Come see Anna. Where are you, honey? Wait a minute. Thank you, honey. You heard when she was just a little thing. She called and asked me to speak, and this was the Sunday I had available. And so I appreciate the invitation. It's good to see so many of the people that I've known since an encouragement. This is most people I've seen in the assembly since pre-COVID. And so, keep up the good work. Thank you, Dale, where did you get there? Right there. Thank you for a good message in Sunday school. I'm a big picture guy, so I'm going to tell you that up front, and that may or may not help you stay with me, because the Holy Spirit is connecting a lot of dots on this planet and in my life right now. Right now, this is a now moment for us. You're here for such a time as this. And the only thing you have in here that's relevant is this. If you're not going to stand on the authority of God's word, you might as well close your doors and tell your new pastor not to come. But you've already made some decisions which make me think that you are acknowledging the authority. There's something going on right this minute that has never happened before in the world. My good friend David Francis and my other good friend Mark Kennedy, both retired Methodist minister, are both speaking in a disaffiliated Methodist church right now, and I'm like, and I'm the Baptist, so I'm doing it on this end. So, and we were talking about that yesterday. So it's an exciting moment in history. Jesus is about to come. His disciples are asking him about that. And so in Matthew 24, and you that know your Bibles are going to know this, because Matthew 24, Luke 21, Mark 13, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, are all dealing, all the book of Daniel is dealing with the things we're going to look for. And a lot of people in Christianity don't want to talk about signs. Well, listen, guys, get over it. Jesus talks about signs. I went to Tampa to see Cousin Chuck a few years ago. Never been to Tampa. One sign said Tampa 500, the next said Tampa 300, the next said Tampa 100. All that meant was I was getting closer to Tampa. A sign is to let you know you're getting closer to a place or an event. Jesus lists in Matthew 24 one thing after the other that will be signs of his return. Okay, I'm assuming you know all that. So look at verse 37, he's going to give you the children's message, okay? He says in verse 37 of Matthew 24, the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. In those days, they were eating and drinking before the flood. They were, and that's an important word, before. So 600 years of his life before the flood, 350 years of his life after the flood. And I've got messages. Have me back when your new pastor gets here for this little January Bible study on the days of Noah. So, lots going on before, lots going on after. That takes us to Genesis 11 with the power of battle. Okay? A lot of that has to do with technology. A lot of this has to do with things you and I have never talked about in church. Okay? So he says, it's going to be just like the days before the flood, they were marrying and giving in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark. Is it okay if I don't stand up there? Okay. This is a key verse because Luke does not include this verse. Verse 39 is not included anywhere else. Jesus says, they did not understand.
They did not know. They did not perceive. Look, until the day the flood came and took them all away, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Very important verse. Very important. Y'all heard the old tale about how you cook a frog without it knowing it, put it in a pot of water, right? Turn up the temperature. Everybody nodded. You've heard that story, okay? I thought everybody on the planet heard it. Okay. And you just gradually turn up the temperature until frog cooks, but he doesn't even know. He's unaware that you've been cutting up the temperature. That's what Jesus, he's the first to use that illustration right there. They did not know. Well, how in the world did they not know? This man's been out there for 120 years building this ark. They've been making fun of him. He's the, according to the New Testament, he's the preacher of righteousness. They didn't know. What do you mean they didn't know? Jesus makes an interesting comment on the cross about God forbidding that they know not what they do. And then Paul backs up and agrees. Oh gosh, I have too much to talk about. All right, Genesis 6, there's an oath. Believe it or not, this isn't even a sermon. This is prologue. Okay, Genesis 6. Now, I'm just going to go from memory because I'm going to go to my next scripture passage and assume that you know all about Genesis 6 and 7, 8, 9, 10. Listen, it all starts from Genesis 3. Everything's connected to Genesis 3. That's the fall of humankind. Everything can be traced there. Especially, do not forget this, because you're seeing this blitzed in your face every day, every hour of every day. What the serpent did to Adam and Eve is the difference between relative truth and absolute truth. That is what has ruined our planet. That's what's going on today. That's what's killing the church, is relative truth, absolute truth. If you're going to stand on absolute truth, the authority of this right here, you're going to be in a minority, okay? That's just the way it's going to be. But if you want authority and absolute truth, it's right here. Everything. You, Sunday school had a class had some great questions today. And we need to ask those questions. We don't need to be afraid to ask questions. Three wise men up here singing a minute ago, but they weren't three. It was like two times three or whatever it was. I can't count past five. So. Anyway, that's not what the Bible teaches. We don't know how many in the world. It could have been 3, could have been 50. I don't know what it was, but I know this. They were not so wise. They missed Bethlehem by 6 miles. The Bible says they went to Jerusalem, 6 miles north of Bethlehem. That little mistake caused thousands of little baby boys' lives. We need to read the book. We need to understand that our traditions are great, but if they're not based in truth, they're not good at all. They're going to lead us to the wrong location, and others might have to pay the cost. We just went through Christmas time. I tell people every year, your Lord activity things are wonderful. Take the wise men out of there because they weren't there. They didn't get there until at least 2 years later and went to the house. And I'm telling you, that mistake caused a lot of lives. So, read and understand this book. And as you get into this book, you'll begin to understand that the days of Noah started in Genesis 6. Very interesting because it talks about in Genesis 6:1, the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they decided, I love somebody. And they took them for a while. A lot of debate in theological circles about what that is, but most people agree that the sons of God, because it shows up again in the book of Job, is referring to the fallen angels. Whatever it was, God did not like it because in the second or third verse of Genesis 6, he says, no, we ain't doing this. He said, I'm going to wipe it all out. What? Same thing Dr. Stella Emanuel just said that they're doing on us the last 3 years. They're trying. Listen, transhumanism is new, guys. Transhumanism started way back there in Genesis, where you begin to monkey around with God's creative order. When you start monkeying around with God's creative order, it doesn't matter how you have to deceive the people.
there. When you do that, God's not happy. God's not happy with what's going on this planet right now. I can tell you He's not. And you and I are the only light for Jesus. Y'all just read it in that prayer. We have to let the light shine. We have to let the salt out of the salt shine. Big. I mean, we're living in a big moment, guys. We don't have near as much time left as most people think. And so, when you get to Genesis 6, God's disappointed, He's grieved, and and He says, I'm going to wipe it all out. All right, you know the story. Okay, so Noah survives by the grace and favor of God. Eight people made it out of that disaster alive. And it took them almost no time to mess up. And you get to Genesis 11 and 12, then you get over to 19, and you realize, oh my Lord, did they not learn anything? No, we don't learn. Here's what we don't learn today. I'm going to be honest with you, this may insult you, but it doesn't, because I'm in the pot. We are the frogs in the pot. Four signs, all the signs in Matthew 24, four times Jesus uses this sign, so it by far overwhelms the wars and rumors of wars, earthquakes, and all this stuff that we're used to, the attack of 300 miles. The sign he mentioned, thank you, I recognize your wife, and it took me forever to place her in some experience. So, the good news is, y'all don't have to listen to me after I say it. So, here's the deal. As you begin to see what's going on in Genesis, he tells us four times in Matthew 24, the big thing to watch for is deception. And everybody in here is too smart to be deceived. All that is the elder son. That's pride and self-righteousness. You know what that real thing was about there? And all those back to Canaan. Two sons, the same picture came in. Everything's a big picture, guys. Jealousy wrote that guy. So he got his inheritance at the same time as your son. He just didn't go in all that. How did he know, verse 31 that you just read this morning, how did he know that his younger brother was out spending his money on harvest? Nobody told him. We need to read the book, guys. We need to study the book. There's so much that we missed, and so God said, Jesus says there's going to be a deception so terrible that the elect, my elect, could get deceived if that were possible. There's only one reason that I will not be deceived. The Holy Spirit of God. That's it. He is my guard. He is my shield. He is my righteousness. He is my director in life. And when I'm not following and walking and abiding in the Word, and the Word's not abiding in me, I'll be on the wrong road every day. And I do that a lot. That's why I can say that. Understand it. So deception. There's been more deception in the last 3 years in the United States of America than I've ever seen in my lifetime. But I just had a birthday this week. 9 years young as this one. So, now I'm going to show you real quick in the last hour. I'm going to show you the conditions of our planet, especially our country. But these are the conditions when we're in the days of Noah, in the days of Lot, Sodom and Gomorrah. Jesus said, "What's like that? I'm coming." He said, "I didn't say that." Jesus said that. And here are the conditions that Paul says exist in a country, a church, a culture, a society. Here are the conditions that are going to be going on right before it comes. Look at Romans, if you've got a Bible, look at Romans chapter 1. I'm going to shut off some of my hard work. While you're looking that up, then look at what that says on that t-shirt.
Romans 1:18-32.
Romans 1:18-32 is exactly where we're living right now. Okay? And on the back, I have big verse 32, we call it two
2015, and I remember the day it happened. Actually, did it in 2014, and Supreme Court changed it in 2015 and made it legal. I went to church that night and told the people who just seen verse 32 of Romans 1 fulfilled on earth to perform my presence. Folks, we are living in prophetic hours. It's amazing. So what is Romans 1, 18 through 32? What's this t-shirt all about? Do you like the design, man? Yes, we came up with this. And I'm not a design guy, so you know now that that is not my gift. I just wanted to use it, and I laid out my resume, gave away to friends as a witnessing tool. And I had an opportunity for my doctor this week to look at that and ask me for it. And there's a witnessing read right there. I said, well, buddy, if you can take time to read that, I'm telling you that's exactly where we're living today. And are you there? In those verses, because here's what it says. Now, I'm not going to read them verse by verse because I do not have the time. But here's what it says in verse 18, that the wrath of God is revealed from where? Heaven, against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of man that has done something. What has humans done? Suppress the truth in unrighteousness. There's the battle that started in Genesis 3 between relative truth and absolute truth. I just told you a minute ago, you're going to be bombarded with that every day of your life. You already are. You're just either aware of it or you're not. The serpent says, you're not going to die. Your eyes are going to be open. Guess what? Two verses later, your eyes were open. Much bigger than a physical vision. And you're going to be like, God, knowing good for me. Well, that's exactly what happened. Because God said that in Genesis 3. How in the world did a serpent die? Gotta be people of good, guys. So in Romans 1, he says, this is what happens to a country, a church, a culture, when they have turned God away. Has anybody read Jonathan Cox, the Rabbi Jonathan Cox's new book, The Return of the Gods? Not a person there, except my wife. Just came out about 6 months ago. Nobody? Read it. That's how we got this place in which we're all right. This spiritual warfare is going on right now is beyond those Christians' imaginations. So, as you begin to see this, God's word says in Romans 1, 18 through 32, that a process begins, and here's the process of the Holy Ghost. God turns over humanity. All right, I'm going to turn over with you real quick because there's several real interesting verses. But read all those verses, study them. Most people have been studying this passage for years. One of my buddies in Fed was an engineer. He said, now I'm not living in Romans 1, 18 through 32. I have no clue what's going on. He said, there is no, this is an engineer, this is not a preacher. He said, there is no other explanation other than this right here. To what we're seeing in our world. Okay? Put the Supreme Court people on the bench who she cannot give a definition of the word woman. That's not ignorance. She knows. She's a product of Romans 1, verse 28, which says that they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, so God gave them over to the depraved and reprobate mind to do the things that are not right. Everything you're watching is right here in these verses. First thing God does in verse 21 is he turns them over because they're exchanging the glory of God for incorruptible God. They begin to humanize. Watch what people do. We started doing this in the 50s and the 60s when I was born. I'm going to the 50s. And we started humanizing God. We started doing it in the churches too. They didn't even know we were doing it. Some of our language. Man upstairs. Oh, that's no big deal. Really? We're an Old Testament. We're structured. So look at what Paul says in these verses. This is what the days of Noah produces in our lifetime. Therefore, God does something, verse 24, gives them over to the lust of their heart, to impurity, that their bodies might be dishonored among them, for they exchange the truth of God, there it is, for a lie. And they worship and serve the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed by God forever. There it is. Can I say that we're not in front of your face every day? Well, there's reason God gave it over to the degrading passions, and the women exchange their natural function for that which is unnatural. And in the same way, men also abandoned their natural function for the woman and burned in their desires toward one another. Men with men committing indecent acts and receiving in their own persons the due penalty of their error. So we not only, when we push God out of society and out of our culture, not only do we humanize him, we start to deify man. We humanize God and then we deify man. We're our own gods. You can make decisions. God gives them up. Verse 28, we just read it. Therefore, we're seeing this in our faces every day. There is no other explanation of some of the things we're seeing in here other than that is a depraved or reprobate mind. When you can call evil good and good evil, and when our leaders 2 days ago on January 6th stood in front of microphones one after the other and declared that 2 years earlier 5 police officers died at the Capitol. That is a lie. That's a reprobate mind because not one police officer died that day. You know who died on January 6th at the Capitol? A female named Ashley Babbitt, who was a veteran. She was unarmed. We've listened to the lie so much, just like, okay, read the books on Anthony Fauci and find out who he is and what he's been doing for 30 years. Folks, this is not some never lie that we can come in here and do our little things on Sunday and feel good about ourselves and that. All that stuff may be good, enjoy it, but understand this is the most relevant thing you've got. This is your authority, the Word of the Living God. And he says, I'm giving you signs. Tell you, time's running short. Won't be long before I come back. The guys I hang with, they're like, oh, Lord, just come on back today. I mean, you don't want to see none of that stuff. Well, here's the deal. He's going to come back at the perfect time. When it's his time, and we're here today by his favor, and we're here to be his life. So when you go through the rest of Romans 1, 18 through 32, you begin to see something. And this is what stirs me the most, because I began to see things recently that I never saw before. Here's what happens when reprobate or unprincipled minds take over your leadership. Watch. You're filled with what? Verse 29. Unrighteousness, wickedness, greed, envy, hurt, strife, deceit, malice, gossip, swagger, haters, mob, counsel, arrogant, boastful, watch this next one. Inventors. The Bible says we become inventors of evil. I hope you've said that. I hope you've said some things recently and you're going to do it. The Bible said that. We want to start inventing different forms of evil. We now have hospitals in this country, and I can name some of them. It's documented proof that are doing sexual mutilation on children. Well, that's nothing new. They started making eunuchs out of people in the Old Testament. What's a transgender? They're using terms now. I don't even understand the definition. I have to research it enough. We have been led to a place, and here's the simplicity of my wife's faith, that she started seeing it 3 years ago. She used two words. She said, violence is evil continual. Evil continual. And something rung a bell in my head. Something about Genesis 6. I said, that's exactly what Genesis 6 says. They have become evil continual. And she began to tell me what was going on. I didn't start studying what's going on until 18 months ago. I'm blown away. Thank goodness for a research brand available. Thank goodness for Dr. Robert Bloom, the scientist in Virginia, and what he said sparked my investigation and my study of what was going on, and the deception that's underway right under our nose, and how they're all in on it. And there's only a few standing against it. And I can give you an example after example after example. You were sitting there going, yes, and he's using, the enemy is using the weapons that he knows works against us. I asked my buddy, and I said, why hasn't he changed his strategy from Genesis 3 till now? He said, because it still works. Which tells me the church has done a poor job of studying the work. I've done a poor job of studying the work and understanding the whys, the questions that were asked back there today. Those are questions we need to talk about, explore, and then get big with our questions. We shouldn't run away from questions. We should embrace truth, absolute truth, to help us answer. And here's what happened on Air Force One back in 2009. Last verse, verse 32. That's why I put it on the back and think of the others. Anybody want to read what verse 32 says? Those that know better, do work. Anybody looking at the Bible? When this culture gets to this place, what does it say? The leaders that know better, right? Romans 1:32. This young man's mom said, what does it say?
It says, they don't ask the Greek, that those who practice those things deserve to die, yet they not only do them, but even the law of the church.
Do you hear it? That's the word of the living God. Those that know better, and they know that those actions that he's just listed in that turnover process and what cultures and churches and countries are doing, they deserve death. No, they're not going to kill them. They're not going to prosecute them. That's why you're not going to see any prosecutions in the federal government. All you're going to see is hearings and investigations that result in nothing because they don't want absolute truth. Why? Because they'll have to be a coward. And a buddy of mine was all excited about getting the Speaker of the House. But I said, listen, tell me what's going to change. Go back to Ali North and Iran-Contra. Go back to all the investigations and the hearings in Congress in the last 30 years, and you tell me where one person was prosecuted. We don't want absolute truth because it brings with it. Here's what's hard for the church. Look at the cross. He had to die for me. And so he's just read it out of God's Word, verse 32 is where we're living. When he picked up the phone on Air Force One, he called Jason Collins in 2013. And he said, I just want to brag on you and commend you, NBA basketball player, for being the first to come out and reveal that you're gay. I said, he knows better than that. He's fulfilling the Word of God and doesn't even know it. How long did it take? 27 months after that phone call? Before he sprang door so that we don't get in America. Is there a man in this church going by named Jim Harrison? Wasn't. I knew Jim. I worked with Jim a little bit. He put a flagpole out of the legacy on that issue years ago. I want you to let that legacy be raised. See, my buddy down east is confronted with this issue. Now, this is just one issue of all these issues. This is the one that's dividing Methodists right now, okay? That's fine. Some issues are going to divide. But when that happened, he had a friend at his home church, Mount Olive United Methodist Church, where he was born and raised. Man was his principal. He came to him and he said, David's my buddy. David's a minister. And he just said this. He said, David, you may not agree with what they're doing and their lifestyle, but you got to love them. And I said, stop right there. We have to be educated about what to say and the questions to ask. And I just looked at David and I said, if that ever happens again, you look at whoever does that and says, say this, do you love them? When the person says, you got to love them, do you love them? And they're going to hesitate before they answer, but they're going to say, yeah. Then say, do you really love them? And they're going to hesitate again, and they're going to say, well, love setting you free. The truth will not only set you free, but that's a misquote of the scripture. It says it'll be. If I'm in jail, come set me free, buddy. I'll need that. There's something better than being set free as being made. So I said, David, when you get in, you're going to be in these discussions. You've already been in these discussions. If there's people and friends and families where you don't love, we don't even know the definition of love. If you love somebody, you're under obligation to share the truth. But that gets to the real issue. Most do not believe that that lifestyle is a sinful lifestyle. Now, it is either a sinful lifestyle, just like gluttony, just like drunkenness. It's either a sinful lifestyle or it's not. There, you go right back to the Romans and Scripture. Is it Scriptures, your authority, or not? That's what this is all about in the Methodist Church. This is what it's all going to be about in the Catholic Church this year when Catholicism splits down the middle. It's all about what is your authority? Those questions in Sunday school were good because they forced me to go back through Scripture. Yeah, there's a lot of things we need here. He used the word a lot. And I think what he said, there's a lot of good points that people make, but relevance and the authority is right here. And love somebody enough to say, look, I'm going to share the truth with you. Because the truth is all that. That first time in my life, God introduced me to a homosexual man that was sitting there in my Bible studies a few years ago. And I was like, see, I was born out here in February. I'm a redneck. I'm still a redneck. Backwards guy. Don't bring any of that around me. God introduced me to this man. He sat there in my Bible study. He loved it. And he wanted to talk to me. We talked. And he said to me, that church had made a real mess to deal with him. I said, right. And he continued with all the mistakes that church had made, and I said, and I represent that because I've been pastor for over 3 decades. And when he finished, I said, let me share this with you. We do need to love people genuinely, but love without truth is nothing but liberalism. Truth without love is nothing more than humbleness. And I said, I'm going to tell you the truth. I care enough about you to tell you that love is wonderful, but it's only the truth that will set you free. And he heard that. And then God had to kind of move me to another location because I was like, I'm not ashamed to him. The Holy Spirit, because that man took my mind over and he had it rebound at whatever hurt time. That's how I call him in this Bible. And he handed it back as a Christian gift at Christmas. The Holy Spirit said, now, hug me. Now that you've told me the truth, hug me. Well, that was all redneck, you know. I've heard this. Before I walked away from that man's apartment, I said, I gotta love you. And Jesus said, I told me the truth. And that's what's going to set you free. See, when you're hearing a bigger picture, because we're in the midst of this thing, guys, and there's more going on than meets the eye. Well, this is the next thing on the agenda. We got to do that because Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, if you don't take that offering, so are we going to seem to do that? Your Sunday school thing was off the card. So let's do the offertory. Thank you for having me. I'm available to teach if you need anything. That's all I'm doing. What I'm here a little bit of it is preaching, most of it is teaching. What the Holy Spirit is revealing to me day by day. How it connects. How it's relevant to everything you're watching in your world. Thank you for having me.
Kevin and his wife. I know you will. Share truth with them. Don't try to hide truth from anybody. Share truth with them. Can you leave it off for me?
Thank you, Dale.
Well, thank you, Jim.
Thank you.
And most of y'all know my wife because she worked here in Goldston for years. Matter of fact, Dale was probably the worst employer she ever had at the bank. I'm cussing with you. He was her boss there for a while at the bank, and they got along great together. We had a little church service stuff they would have more.
Yes.
We ran into her and had a great time. Love each other in Jesus. Thank you, Dale.
Thank you.
We'll continue our time of worship. We're leaving. If the usher will come forward, please.
Thank you.
extinguished, is that the right word? It's still going. Val, thank you for sharing today. Now I ask you to go ahead and make your way down the street. You folks will have a chance to speak to you on the way out and see you for joining me. Glad to have you all. Thank you each one for being here today. It's a privilege, it's an honor, it's a blessing to be able to serve. And personally, it's a blessing to be able to serve with you all. It's been a great day. And as Val just told us, as we leave the service today, our work is beginning. We need to go